promote the consultation.
Thank you, and thank you everybody for rattling through. We got through all the questions. I'm moving straight on to the next item of business, but it's very tight with questions. The next item of business is a statement by Keith Brown on the Enterprise and Skills Review. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement. There will be no interventions or interruptions. A call on Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary, 10 minutes.
Presiding Officer, today I wish to provide an update on the progress of the Enterprise and Skills Review, which aims to align and improve our enterprise and skills system. In doing so, I'm fulfilling the commitment I made to Parliament in January to provide an update on the governance aspects of the review. Since January, there have been two debates within this chamber which have highlighted the Parliament's views on matters relating to the Strategic Board. On both occasions, Scottish ministers have been clear that we would listen to the views expressed. I have done this, and I'm thankful for the opportunity to address the concerns which have been raised. As well as talking about governance today, I also want to highlight our vision for a more productive and inclusive economy and the economic objectives that we want to achieve. When I published phase one of the Enterprise and Skills Review in October last year, I set out the level of the challenge which the Scottish economy faces, in particular the urgent action necessary as a result of the EU referendum. Despite these challenges, the Scottish economy continues to perform, and I'm delighted to note that we have recently progressed to the second OECD quartile for productivity. This demonstrates that the fundamentals of the Scottish economy are strong and that progress is possible with sustained and concerted effort. We have substantial natural resources, one of the most highly educated workforces in Europe, a long-standing reputation for innovation and an internationally recognised brand. We are world leaders in key industries of the future, such as life sciences, financial services and financial technology, as well as creative industries and sustainable tourism. However, the status quo will not deliver the economic step change necessary to realise our ambition to rank in the top quartile of OECD countries for productivity, for equality, for well-being and sustainability. Productivity drives the overall standard of living in our economy and the competitiveness of our businesses. A step change in productivity will deliver an opportunity to see higher wages, greater competitiveness and increased quality of life for everyone across Scotland. This review is exploring how our agencies can leverage the strong fundamentals of our economy to help individuals and businesses realise their ambition, taking advantage of the rich opportunities that exist in Scotland. As just one example of our increasing effort, I will be committing £1 million next financial year and for the following 3 years to create a new Scottish Public Sector Innovation Challenge Fund. I have asked Scottish Enterprise to lead on this and to work with partners to scale up the fund in 2017, 2018 and future years. This fund will use the public sector's demand for improved services to stimulate and support the development and commercialisation of innovations from Indigenous supply chain companies. This approach will benefit everyone by finding innovative private sector-led solutions for complex public sector issues, improving services for citizens across the whole of Scotland, saving money and increasing opportunities for business innovation. The enterprise and skills system is fundamental to achieving our ambitions. Our agencies, sharing a common purpose and strong leadership, can create the conditions to increase productivity and help deliver the skills that Scotland's people and economy need. That is why we put productivity growth at the centre of our vision of the Enterprise and Skills Review. We recognise and appreciate the vital contribution that the four agencies, that's Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Skills Development Scotland and the Scottish Funding Council, make to creating a more successful country, delivering opportunities across Scotland which support inclusive and sustainable economic growth. So far from diminishing the role of the agencies, I want this review to set out how we can enhance the impact of the investment that we make on economic and skills development here in Scotland. We want our agencies to create some of the best conditions in the world for inclusive growth, and that's why the review is exploring how our agencies can transform the services, the skills and the support necessary for business and individuals across Scotland to be successful. I want to create a system of enterprise and skill support that's greater than the sum of its parts. Many of the responses to phase one of the review highlighted the need for greater alignment in order to deliver greater economic impact, and that includes Audit Scotland. Our commitment to create a strategic board will deliver greater collaboration, innovation and common purpose across the agencies. While support for the strategic board has been considerable, it was clear that there were concerns about how it would impact on our agencies, particularly in relation to Highlands and Islands Enterprise and the Scottish Funding Council. And I agree that any new arrangement has to carefully balance the different interests of the regions of Scotland and the full statutory functions and responsibilities of each agency. And that's why I asked Professor Lorne Crerar, Chair of Highlands and Islands Enterprise, to lead discussions with his fellow chairs and others to scope potential structures and functions for the new board and to consider how that would align with arrangements at agency level. And I would like to thank Professor Crerar for his considered and detailed paper. He has shown a great personal commitment and objectivity in taking forward this work. And I've also reflected on his proposals and the views expressed in this chamber in the debates which I previously mentioned, and also more widely in determining the role, function and structure for the Strategic Board and its relationship to governance at an agency level. Similarly, I've tested all of this against what will best deliver our ambitions. So my intention is to build on Professor Crerar's proposals and to establish a Strategic Board with the aims that he identified and also with a further aim: to deliver wider collective leadership based on common culture and values and which inspires and empowers delivery. The final aim recognises the need for a step change in the culture across the system and with those that they engage with. And this must take the shape of fundamental, meaningful collaboration reflected in day-to-day joint working at every level. The board, which I can confirm today will be led by an independent chair from the business community, will develop a strategic plan underpinned by common evidence performance measures upon which agencies can collaborate. Each agency will have a seat at the table through their chair, and they will be joined by strong non-executive members drawn from wider economic and societal interests, including members with experience of business, local government, research and skills, and the trade unions. We recognise the need for change following the Phase 1 report, but I've listened to the views of Parliament that more can be done within the existing structures to drive change. Professor Crerar has also helpfully set out a way that he thinks we can achieve this, and on that basis, I do not intend to bring forward legislation to change the name, the functions or structures of the agency boards. I have listened to a wide range of voices over the last few months, including my Highlands and Islands SNP parliamentary colleagues, MSPs from other parties. I've spoken to the spokespeople for each of the opposition parties. I've spoken to the business community, and they have asked the business community in particular that across the parties, that if we can, and as far as we can, if we can demonstrate consensus on the fundamental importance of business support and enterprise, that's of particular value to the business community. And in particular, I have listened to this Parliament. And so I confirm today that the boards of High, the SFC and the other agencies will remain, but there's an absolute expectation that the agencies will work to align their delivery to maximise their positive impact on the economy. As I've previously promised, High will continue to be locally based, managed and directed, and the new arrangements will protect and enhance their unique service. As recommended in Professor Crerar's report, I will obviously want to work to develop the functions of the boards along with the boards themselves, consistent with their existing statutory basis, to ensure that they can collaborate effectively to deliver the strategic board's purpose and to achieve our overall vision. I also recognise the value in bringing the agencies together quickly to form an implementation board. This will also include some members of the Ministerial Review Group and will develop the detailed work necessary to bring the Strategic Board into being. Phase 2 of the review began in November 2016 and is due to last for 6 months. In the coming weeks, I'll publish a report demonstrating progress across all areas during Phase 2. For example, it will highlight work that Visit Scotland are leading in collaboration with other agencies that will result in powerful, consistent messaging and identify an identity which can be used across different government agencies, universities and business collectively and individually where and when appropriate. That narrative and campaign will use our natural and built assets, be it the renowned beauty of our landscapes and seascapes, our rich history and the culture of the pioneering drive across Scotland, across academia and industry, to show what a modern and progressive Scotland can offer to the world. And measures such as this one, which will support our international economic aims, will be crucial in helping us to deliver our collective ambitions. I'm setting out the principles of the governance architecture today to allow us to rapidly progress these progressive initiatives across the whole range of the review. To repeat, though, the reform to the governance structure that I have set out here, as well as the supporting initiatives which I've laid out, remain a means to an end. The core purpose of this review is to drive a step change in the performance of our economy and to deliver strong, vibrant and inclusive growth. And I am confident that those ambitions are shared by everyone in the chamber, and I hope they'll endorse them. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now take questions on the issues raised in this statement. I allow 20 minutes for questions. I have 16 people listed to ask questions. I say to Dean Lockhart, you were not in at the opening of this statement. I've had no letter or note of excuse for that. So you're slipping to the bottom of my list of questioners, as I would do to anybody else. Have the courtesy to be here when statements are read out, as every other questioner was. I call Jackie Bailey. Miss Bailey, please.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for an advance copy of his statement? I confess I feel some sympathy. It's been a bad week for Keith Brown. On Tuesday, he announced the delays to the Queen's Ferry crossing. On Wednesday, he had to apologise for being conned by a Chinese investor. Today, though, he appears to have performed a series of spectacular U-turns. The Parliament made clear that it wanted to retain Highlands and Islands Enterprise and the Scottish Funding Council in their current form. There was support for Scottish Enterprise and Skills Development Scotland too. So I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's apparent change of mind to abandon legislating for a new board. But let me warn him that trying to exert control in another way doesn't respect the will of Parliament. So I would be grateful if he would confirm that the new board is not statutory. I also find it strange that Keith Brown is not chairing the board, and he knows that's my view. John Swinney used to chair the Strategic Forum. The Cabinet Secretary's denial of chairing the board downgrades its importance and actually blurs the lines of accountability. So surely if the Cabinet Secretary thinks that the economy is so important, and I believe he does, then he should chair the Strategic Board.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I first of all thank Jackie Bailey for her genuine and sincere concern for my welfare. But just to come back to the points which were mentioned, it's also true to say, I think the Labour Party said to me recently in general questions, it was that if we were to do as they have asked us to do, that would be a sign of strength and not of weakness. So that didn't seem to last too long. On the issue of the Strategic Board, I think it is important, and it's not just the members of this chamber, and members from other parties have also said that they would prefer, unlike Jackie Bailey, not to have a minister chair the board. It's not solely because of those representations, but some very strong representations I've had from within the Ministerial Review Group, some very powerful arguments about having a strong business background chair could mean to the progress of the board. So that is why we've taken that decision in relation to that. Ministers, of course, will input to the board. That's bound to be the case. On the other points that Jackie Bailey raises, no, it's not the case that this will be a statutory board. There is no reason, I think, why it can't have as much, possibly even more effectiveness by not being a statutory board. And that does also meet some of the concerns of other members of this chamber. There's no way I can conceivably meet all the concerns of every member and every party within this chamber, but what I do have to do is take a balanced approach to all the representations I've received. I did promise to listen, and I have listened, and I'll continue to listen.
Yes, sorry about that. Call James Dornan, followed by Liz Smith. Mr. Dornan, short question, short answers, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the dedicated, locally based support managed and directed by HIE will remain in place alongside its role to work in close collaboration with the other agencies for the benefit of the economy?
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
As I've said repeatedly, the Highlands and Islands do great work. Highlands and Islands Enterprise do great work in the Highlands, and this government is determined to support it to continue to do that work. I've also previously promised that HIE will continue to be locally based, managed and directed, and the new arrangements will protect and enhance their unique service. HIE will continue to have a board with its core functions as set out in statute remaining legislatively unchanged, and the new arrangements will not only protect the unique service that HIE delivers for our Highlands and Island economies, but through the collaboration which we're seeking with other agencies, that can enhance support available to businesses, employers and employees across the region.
Liz Smith, followed by Richard Lockhead. Ms Smith, please.
Thank you. Can I warmly welcome what is a very substantial U-turn on the original recommendation to scrap the individual boards? And can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, in the case of the Scottish Funding Council, for which only part of its activities are directed at skills and enterprise, could you confirm that any formal collaboration with the other agencies via the new strategic board is for these activities only, that the statutory and legal basis of the current SFC board will not in any way be diminished, and that it would still be for Parliament to determine the allocation of funding to the Scottish Funding Council?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say that there is no intention to change, I think Liz Smith, if I heard right, was the functions and structures of SFC, and that is the case, that is the intention to do that. the board will be remaining. I did say in my statement that we will work to develop the boards themselves. That's been part of the review, which has been recommended by Lorne Creer. Wasn't specifically mentioned in relation to SFC, but we'll continue to have a dialogue, as we always do, about the nature of the boards. The board will not be abolished. The board will stay where it is. We're not going in looking at the structures of the board in addition to that. And the other point that I would make is that in addition to that, what you could see is a strengthening, perhaps, of the board, because the chair of the board of the Funding Council will also sit on the strategic board, as will the chairs of other agencies. I'm not sure that's picking up about all the points of concern that Liz Smith's expressed. If I've missed one, then I'm happy to respond to her in writing.
I'm afraid there's no supplementaries. Richard Lockhead, followed by Rhoda Grant.
Can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's statement and for confirming that the HIE board will continue in its current form? Will he also recognise the important role played by HIE Moray in attracting the company Cura to Forres, saving local jobs with the potential to grow many more? And will he also confirm that HIE Moray will continue its good work in the times ahead, particularly given the threat to the Moray economy posed by the hard Brexit policy of the Conservative Party?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can confirm those things, but crucially in relation to the last point that Richard Lockhead makes, it was quite clear from both the Phase 1 and subsequent discussions that, especially in the Highlands and Islands, the fear about Brexit, and in particular in relation to European structural and other funds, where they have performed a function that the UK government departed from in the 1980s, is absolutely crucial, and there's an extreme level of worry about the nature of that support and whether it will continue post-Brexit. This is one of the major challenges which this review is seeking to address.
Rhoda Grant, followed by John Finney.
Thank you. While the retention of the High Board is welcome, a board with no power is useless. The parts of the statement that worry me is where the Cabinet Secretary says that agencies will work to align their delivery and that they deliver the strategic board's purpose to achieve our overall vision. If they have to conform to a Scotland-wide delivery plan, purpose and vision, how does this allow for local accountability and decision-making? Therefore, can I ask who's boss, the strategic board or the High Board?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't think there's anything further I can say to answer the concerns expressed by Rhoda Grant, but I don't understand them. I've said that the board will remain as it is. It will have the powers that it currently has. It's not going to be second-guessed in terms of its strategic investments. It will continue to take the decision-making which it's had up until now. But why anybody would object to the idea that our main enterprise and skills agencies should collaborate and align for the greater purpose of improving economic performance across Scotland? I don't know. It's my responsibility to make sure that happens. It's also the responsibility of each of the agencies with their boards in Scotland to ensure that happens. That's a perfectly proper and necessary ambition for us to have, and I don't understand why. I don't know whether it's the whole Labour Party or just Rhoda Grant that opposed that, but in short answer to the question, High will have the powers that it currently has.
John Finney, followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for early sight of the statement and for listening on the High Board. The Cabinet Secretary will recognise the role that social enterprises play in economic growth, particularly in the Highlands and Islands. If the policies to align the agencies, will the Cabinet Secretary broaden Scottish Enterprises' remit to encompass social enterprises, and will he agree to meet with me and Green Party colleagues regarding some continuing concerns?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I first of all thank John Finney for his willingness to engage in this process. I've listened to him as I've listened to many members, Highlands and Islands MSPs from my own party as well as MPs as well, who made very strong representations on this. I should just make clear, first of all, that it is the intention that the social function of Highlands and Islands Enterprise, as I've just said to Rhoda Grant, will remain. That function will remain. It's also my intention that should be the same for the South of Scotland Agency. They should have a similar power in relation to that. It's also my belief that Scottish Enterprise currently have the ability to do many of those things which John Finney seeks. But in order to make sure that we can bottom that out, I am, of course, more than willing to meet with John Finney and his colleagues.
Tavish Scott, followed by Jenny Gilruth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also thank the Cabinet Secretary for an advanced copy of his statement? I too would welcome the U-turn, but I'm struggling to square that U-turn with the sentence in his statement that he very carefully delivered, which says the boards will collaborate effectively to deliver the strategic board's purpose and achieve our overall vision. If collaboration and delivering that vision is the purpose of the strategic board, then what are the boards of Highlands Islands Enterprise and the Funding Council going to do?
Cabinet Secretary.
The boards of the Funding Council and Highlands and Islands Enterprise will do the things which they currently do, and in fact it may well be the case that they do substantially more. I've mentioned, and I'm grateful to Tavish Scott for the engagement that we've had on this, that there is also a stream of work which is going on in terms of regionalisation, which may well result in local areas, whether it's at agency board level or at some other level, taking on additional powers currently exercised by other agencies like Skills Development Scotland. So the potential there is for them to be more powerful than they currently are. But it is right, I think, for us to set out an overarching vision which is about increasing productivity, increasing exports, meeting some challenges which don't just apply in one part of Scotland, they apply to the whole of Scotland. So the boards will continue to have the powers and the functions which they currently have. It seems to me we can achieve a lot more if we can make sure the boards come together. For example, I think I've given an example before, in terms of internationalisation, sometimes there is not the collaboration taking place that should take place, and I think people in High told me during the consultation process they had access to one person in SDI. High need to have more resource and more collaboration with the other agencies than is currently taking place. That is the purpose. There is no sinister purpose to the review. It's to increase the benefits for everybody.
Jenny Gilruth, followed by Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that creating a strategic board will help to coordinate the activities of SE, HIE, SDS and the SFC, bringing greater integration and focus to the delivery of our enterprise and skills support?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I absolutely agree, and I think that takes up the point I was trying to respond to Tavish Scott on. It's pretty clear from the overwhelming evidence that we had in phase one of the review of the need to better align the services and the support that our agencies offer in order to deliver opportunities across Scotland, and those opportunities which of course support inclusive and sustainable economic growth. The review aims to help agencies collaboratively transform the services and the skills and support necessary for businesses and individuals across Scotland in order for them to be successful. So I want to create an enterprise and skills system, as I said in my statement, that is greater than the sum of its parts, and introducing a strategic board will assist the four agency boards to align their services, including, in addition, the South of Scotland Agency Board, to achieve greater collaboration, innovation and common purpose.
Douglas Ross, followed by Marie Todd.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the fact that SNP members have now found their voice on this issue, but sadly it was only after their ministers announced this U-turn. Can I ask, like Rhoda Grant, what assurances can be given that decisions taken locally in Moray and across the Highlands and Islands by the Board of HIE won't be overruled by this new strategic body?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm glad that Douglas Ross was able to join after the statement had begun as well, so well done in finding your way to the Chamber.
I will excuse Mr Ross, he was actually trying to locate a colleague.
Can I say that in addition to what I've already said to other members, I've mentioned the fact that the High Boards and of course the consultation and the different councils, including Moray Council, were involved in that consultation. I've had a number of discussions with them. This meets many of the aims which they have said to me in defending the continued existence of the High Board. This statement meets many of those aims. So I think they will be pleased to have this assurance given to them, and I think they also have expressed support. I think Moray Council has expressed support for the strategic board. I'm happy to check that, but I'm fairly sure with a unanimous view from within the Highlands and Islands local authorities. They also asked that further development takes place in relation to the board. They had concerns about the continued current structure of the board, and I'm saying that I will only do that in conjunction and collaboration with the board. So I think that reassurance which Douglas Ross seeks has been provided.
Marie Todd, followed by Daniel Johnson.
Presiding Officer, can the Cabinet Secretary tell me whether HIE will retain its much-valued social role, social responsibility role?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I think this has been one of the strongest points, and members previously in a debate mentioned or quoted, I think from all sides, the words of Jim Hunter. And Jim Hunter, when I met with him, has a number of concerns, not all of which I recognise will be satisfied by this statement. But crucially, he pointed out that when Highlands and Islands Development Board were first established, what there was a necessity to do was to create the capacity in order to take up business and entrepreneurial opportunities. And that meant taking social and sometimes cultural initiatives in order to help build that capacity. I think it's a very strong track record which I have in doing that. I've always said that function should remain. And I would hope that members would welcome the fact that it's also my intention to make sure that facility, that extended remit, is also available to the South of Scotland Agency.
Call Daniel Johnson, followed by Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I note that the Cabinet Secretary failed to answer Liz Smith's point about budgets. Will the Scottish Parliament continue to set the Scottish Funding Council budget, or will that be the responsibility of the new board? And will the new board be able to move money between these agencies? And also, will the chair of the Scottish Funding Council be a ministerial appointment, as is currently the case, or will that fall to the new board?
Cabinet Secretary.
Happy to reassure Daniel Johnson, I think, on both points. No, it will not be an appointment by the Strategic Board. That will be, as is currently the case, by ministers. And also, it will be the case that the current budgetary arrangements will apply. Not the case that the Strategic Board will allocate budgets as between the agencies.
Donald Cameron, followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you. Will the Cabinet Secretary guarantee that the Board of High will indeed retain, and I quote, all strategic, operational and budgetary decisions, given the terms of the motion passed by a majority vote of this Parliament on the 18th of January?
Cabinet Secretary.
I believe that I have given that reassurance a number of times already, but also I think, as has been mentioned by one or two members, with that caveat that I do expect collaboration and alignment between the agencies and their activities. I think that both benefits them and it benefits Scotland as a whole. I've mentioned how, and High will tell you this, and some of the constituent councils in the Highlands and Islands area will tell you this as well, they believe further support is required from other agencies, and I think it's important that happens. I've given the one example in relation to SDI, but it's true across other areas as well, not least, for example, in relation to data. I think it's very important that we have a common, in addition to what the agencies themselves currently do, we have a common function in terms of creating the right data that helps inform these decisions. So I think the Highlands and Islands enterprise will be strengthened and extended in terms of what it does from the current position, and I would hope that the member would welcome that.
Colin Smith, followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I refer members to my register of interest as a local councillor in Dumfries and Galloway? The Cabinet Secretary won't be surprised to know I'm disappointed that he didn't cover the south of Scotland in his statement. So can inform the Chamber today whether he will be accepting the proposal that the new South of Scotland Enterprise Body proposed during phase one of the review will be based on a boundary of the Scottish borders in Dumfries and Galloway, when we can expect the new body to be up and running, given that he has received a proposal from the local authorities for a body that could be established in just a matter of months, and can he give a commitment that the governance arrangements for the new body will mean decisions will be made in the South of Scotland for the South of Scotland, as it would be disappointing if, like the Highlands and Islands, we needed a vote of Parliament to achieve
quickly,
that.
I want to get everything. Cabinet Secretary.
I think there was three questions there, and I hope to cover each of them. So, first of all, in terms of the boundaries, I think that discussions about the boundaries are a key part of the current phase of work. There is, I think I would agree with Colin Smith, an emerging consensus that this should be based upon Dumfries and Galloway and Scottish borders, but there are differing perspectives. And I also think it's very important that we take the temperature of the new councils once they're elected to see if they are agreeable with that. When will decisions about the new vehicle be taken? Phase two of the review began on the 1st of November. We said we'd take 6 months for that, so final phase two decisions are likely to set out a programme of work that will be undertaken, obviously, once that phase two is established. And also, I think what he mentions about the functions and powers of the board, I think I have covered that certainly in the responses I've given previously. It's my intention that they should be similar to those exercised by Highlands and Islands Enterprise. I think that answers the questions, but again, if the member wants to come back to me with anything that's unclear, happy to do that.
Oliver Mundell, followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm disappointed that today's statement made no direct reference to the south of Scotland, and I feel we've had insufficient clarity on what that vehicle will look like. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore confirm the model will be similarly constituted in terms of its governance to High, and can he let us know how the interests of our region will be represented on the Implementation Board, given there isn't an existing structure at the moment?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think at least the last point is a reasonable point. I think the other points I've covered a number of times, but in relation to the last point, I think it's very important that the Implementation Board does have representation, and I acknowledge the point that is not currently a board that's constituted. But I am sure that the member will want to congratulate the Scottish Government in being the ones that have taken forward a South of Scotland agency when no previous government has done that. That will be an achievement for this government.
John Mason, followed by Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. I mean, I think both the review and the Economy Committee found that there was a certain amount of duplication and perhaps not the best use of resources amongst the different agencies. Can the Cabinet Secretary assure us that there'll be an improvement on that moving forward? There'll be more coordination than there has been?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think that has to be around the point about collaboration and alignment. And I don't think there's any member here, I don't think there's any member of the boards which I've been talking about that would say there's no duplication. And if there is duplication, that's a pound that's being spent which doesn't need to be spent. And we need every pound to work for the people of Scotland. So, yes, John Mason is quite right. We want to make sure that we address issues of duplication, and we will do that, especially in relation to some of the activities, obviously, of Funding Council and Skills Development Scotland, where they would freely admit there can be some duplication. It's quite right that we get these as lean and also as effective and as efficient as possible, and that we drive out duplication.
Before I call Dean Lockhart, can I thank him for his note and say you've learned the hard way, but that business in here follows on, and all members should watch out and not say, just think that preempt that they're going to be taken at a certain time. So you've all learned the lesson. I learned it once myself, so it's a hard lesson, but it's learned. I now call you, Mr. Lockhart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I can assure you and the Cabinet Secretary that I was busy reading his statement, if that makes any difference. Let me start by welcoming the U-turn made by the Cabinet Secretary, and I agree with the Cabinet Secretary, we need a step change in the economy. However, this step change will not be delivered by tinkering with the organisation of the agencies. It needs leadership and clear policy direction and implementation by this government. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does he agree with Audit Scotland's conclusion when it reviewed the enterprise agencies, when they said the enterprise agencies are performing well, but the Scottish Government needs a clearer plan for delivering its economic strategy?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the answer to that question is based on the very fact of this review. The review acknowledges the fact that some things, especially in relation to competitiveness, in relation to exports, in relation to the international facing nature of our businesses, we have more to do. I acknowledge that fact. I think we've discussed previously the issue of the overarching economic strategy of the government, which will be informed, as it has to be informed, by pressures like Brexit, which is a huge pressure. We're only starting now to see, even today, we've seen Francis Hollande phoning Angela Merkel and telling her that there will not be a trade deal at the same time as a Brexit deal. That's got huge implications, so we have to prepare ourselves for that. And that is the purpose of this review. There's nothing more sinister in it than making sure that we establish the right structures, the right infrastructure, to make sure that we can take forward what we need to in terms of business support, in terms of data collection, in terms of economic activity, and in terms of skills. That's the whole purpose of this review. And I'm grateful, of course, to Dean Lockhart for the engagement which we've had in relation to this. And I do hope, genuinely hope, because the business community are asking this of us, if we can come together, and I'll continue to seek further common ground where that's possible, in order that we can all be facing in the same direction for the challenges which confront Scotland.
Thank you very much. Are there any other questions? There are no other questions. The next item of business is consideration of three parliamentary bureau motions. I ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 4783 on committee membership, motion 4784 on substitution on committees, and motion 4945 on acting conveners.
Moved on block.
Thank you very much, and we'll take these questions at decision time at 16:45. We'll just wait a few seconds. Thank you. I propose to ask a single question on Parliamentary Bureau Motions 4783, 4784 and 4945. If any member objects, please say so now. No one objects. The question is that we agree motions 4783, 4784 and 4945. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And that concludes decision time. I close this meeting.